Okay, so let's get started for today. We are session 18, and we are in the text, chapter 10, section 5 through chapter 11, section 3 today. So with all this, let's just take a moment to deep breath, centering ourselves, placing our willingness in the forefront. To hear Holy Spirit's voice through all things. And we thank you, Holy Spirit, for your presence in our minds. Amen. Okay, so we are looking today, chapter 10, section 5, page 189. The denial of God. So the last time that we talked, we were talking about all this, the end of sickness and the God of sickness. We're talking about this whole idea. So now let's talk a little bit more about that idea. And he talks about the denial of God. So he starts off, the rituals of the God of sickness are strange and very demanding. Well, that's the ego, right? The ego. So the ego doesn't want us to be joyful, and if we're depressed, it's a sign that, yep, we agree with you. It says allegiance, like we're worshiping the God of sickness. And then it says, well, we don't realize that when we're denying God, that we're denying our true self, our true identity, who we really are. And when we do that, moving into paragraph 2, he says, well, what we do then is we project onto others when we're denying our true self. And so then we're going to get into that blaming and all that we put on other people. It's their fault. It's their fault. It's their fault. And then we believe that what others do to us are real, that we didn't have any stake in it at all. Because remember, of course, tells us that we can change our minds. About what occurs, about what somebody's doing, what a person says or does. In sentence 3 there, he says, you may believe that you judge your brothers by the messages they give you, but you have judged them by the message you give to them. So the way we're treating our brothers, thinking about our brothers, we're not allowing joy to come in. We're thinking, no. You're not a son of God. And if I'm saying you're not a son of God, then I'm saying I'm not a son of God either. And he says it's the denial of the spark that brings the depression. For whenever you see your brothers without it, you are denying God. So when we see our brothers as the guilty, guilty bastards that we think they are, then yeah, we're denying it within ourselves as well. And so top of the page 190 there, paragraph 3, allegiance to the denial of God is the ego's religion. So the more we focus on denying God, and we do that, right, anytime that we're not seeing the truth in ourselves or other people, that's our allegiance that we're making. It's an insane idea. And it talks a little bit about the idea of blasphemy, is self-destructive, not God-destructive. Not denying God isn't going to do anything to God himself. He doesn't care, basically. It's doing something to us down in that level where we're denying God and we're saying we're unworthy and God's unworthy. That's all he says is it's an insane idea. And so then this idea of sickness and death comes into our minds against God's will. This attack on God, paragraph 4, made his son think he was fatherless, that we were alone, that we were abandoned here. And so then out of this belief that we had, the depression comes in. We made the God of depression, ego. And so we feed into that. We probably all know some people, maybe within ourselves, at a one time or another, where they just really fed on the negativity. I've known some people like that, where they're just negative all the time. That's feeding on the ego. And that we didn't want joy. For some reason, we don't want joy. We want to be, you know, angry all the time, judgmental all the time. Da, 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 da. And then you sit there and wonder, how can this person just be so negative all the time? I've never heard a good thing come out of their mouth. That's because they are honoring the ego, the god of depression, the god of sickness. And the thing is we do it to a point too. So it's not like, oh, they're out there and they're doing it, but I don't do it. We all do it to a point because we're still believing we're a body. We still believe we're here. It's paragraph 5. He says, I said before that of yourself, you can do nothing, but you are not of yourself. If you were, what you have made would be true and you could never escape. But we're not of ourselves. We did not make ourselves. God created us so we can escape. We can escape this. And so he says, your gods are nothing because your father didn't create them. He did not create all that that we experience. Then he gets back into this depression thing again. You know, and we probably at all, I mean, I know I've suffered before. Maybe we all have at one time or another in our lives. Even having a little bit of the blues, you know, we've all denied who we are. And depression is isolation. I know I felt that whenever I have been depressed in the past. You know, even if you just feel blue, you feel alone. You feel, I don't want to be with anybody. I don't want to deal with anything. That's all the ego. And in those moments, we just, as we've learned, you know, chapter 4, this need not be. Then we just ask for the help. This need not be, hey, Holy Spirit, help me. And then he goes, paragraph 6, we haven't sinned. We've just been mistaken, and now we need a correction. That's all it was. It was just a simple mistake that we made. And we can get help to undo that. We denied him because we loved him, knowing that if we recognized our love for him, we could not deny God. Our denial of God, therefore, means that you love God, love him, and that you know he loves you. Isn't that funny? We deny that which we know. We know on that deep, deep level within that we love God and he loves us. We accept it. We still accept it. And now he's saying, well, we've accepted denial, but now we can accept the undoing process of letting go of all those feelings that have caused us to deny God, those thoughts that have done that. And in this, he says the next paragraph, paragraph 7, your father hasn't denied you. He does not retaliate. He's not going to punish us. He's going to send us to hell. None of that. He just, come on back. I need you. I love you. When you think he has not answered your call, you haven't answered his. Isn't that an interesting statement? When we think that, oh, but I've called to God, I've called to God, I've called to God, and I don't seem to be getting any help. He's saying, we haven't answered his. We haven't said, oh, yeah, he gave me the Holy Spirit in my mind to help me. He loves me. He's there. He's that presence. He's that bridge between us to help us. And he says, I call to you from every part of the sonship. So we can hear it through our brothers. We can hear it through, you know, in our Holy Spirit class, we're talking about, we can hear it in so many different ways. Through books and music and billboards, any kinds of things. And he says, I'm calling to you throughout the sonship. Tell you of his love for you. If you hear his message, he has answered you, and you will learn of him if you hear aright. The love of God is in everything he created, for his son is everywhere. Look with peace upon your brothers. Wow. And God will come rushing into your heart in gratitude for your gift to him. That's all I need to do. When I have those people in my life that I have a struggle with or really, oh man, I just wish they would change. I have to remember to look within them. Okay, there's another reason why they do what they do. I don't know what that is. Or maybe I will get some enlightenment from Holy Spirit why that is. I can see the truth in them. And I can love them on that level. Now, informed, there may be some things we need to do. We always talk about that, right? You know, informed, we may need to do, take some actions. But on the level of the heart, the mind, spirit level, we can still love those people where they are. He says, don't look to the ego to help you with this for any healing, because it's not going to come. Healing is, you know, we only want to look to the God of love, and that's where the healing lies. Love doesn't die. Moving on to paragraph 9, only the eternal can be loved. Love does not die. What is of God is forever, and we are of God. And he won't let us suffer. If we accept ourselves as God created us, we'll be incapable of suffering. We have to acknowledge him as our creator, is what he says. So there's no sin in us, you know, no matter what we may have learned in the past, there's no sin in us. We're perfect in that spirit state, that love state. It's just that our mind was capable of making something else. And now we can say, no, that's not what I want. I want the love of God, the peace of God to be forefront in my mind. And the thing is he's not going to interfere with us. That's what he says in 10. Because then he says, it's sentence 2 there, paragraph 10. Yet he would not interfere with you because he would not know his son if he were not free. See, we're free. We're free to choose. That's why he doesn't step in and say, oh, no, 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 this is what you got to do. This is the way you got to start thinking. We're given reminders of the truth of who we are in this book, and what Jesus says, and the messages that we hear. But it would be the opposite of what he's trying to do for us if he would try to come in there and just do it for us. It would be bullying us, is what it would be doing, and that's what the ego tries to do, right? The ego bullies us. And he loves us, though. That's it. He loves us, no matter where we are, no matter what it is that we're thinking. You know, if today we, you know, oh, we just love God and we're doing our lessons and we're meditating, whatever, and tomorrow we start shrieking like a banshee to everybody, he doesn't change. There's not going to be a change in him. He still loves us. All we need to do is recognize, okay, boy, I've had a really bad day and I need help. And now I need to choose. So now it's just, I want to know that that's going to be my sanity. And heaven just waits for us to return, turning the page, 192. That is our dwelling place in heaven. So we're not home anywhere else, is what he says. Don't deny ourselves the joy. That is ours. If we listen, that's how we're going to learn to remember who we really are. We've got to take time to listen. So when he keeps saying about, oh, it's blasphemous to perceive us as guilty, you know, don't be listening to the ego saying, oh, I'm blasphemous because I'm not believing this. And that's the ego telling you you're wrong. It's just a statement that he's making. But the ego likes to twist the words of the Course to make us feel guilty, to not let us accept the words here. Listen to the words that say you're wholly joyous. God created you perfect. Listen to those words. Paragraph 13, do not perceive anything God did not create, or you are denying him. His is the only fatherhood, and it is yours only because he has given it to you. He has the real gifts to give us. And then down at the end, arrogance is the denial of love because love shares and arrogance withholds. Right? Arrogance sets us off, keeps us separate, isolated, and alone. But love joins us with God. And then these very last lines, I have those underlined in my book. If you would remember eternity, you must look only on the eternal. If you allow yourself to become preoccupied with the temporal, you are living in time. As always, your choice is determined by what you value. Time and eternity cannot both be real because they contradict each other. If you will accept only what is timeless as real, you will begin to understand eternity and make it yours. So we can't have both. There is only timelessness and eternity. That's who we really are. Yes, we're here in this world and we have schedules, got to pay our bills on time and these sorts of things. But I can still know that I'm timeless. I'm okay. I'm held in eternity with God. So now we're going to start looking at chapter 11. This chapter is called God or the Ego. God or the Ego. So we start off with this introduction. And he says, either God or the ego is insane. If you will examine the evidence of both sides fairly, you will realize this must be true. The ego is going to tell us that God's insane, right? That's what he's going to tell us. God's saying the same thing. They want us to side with them. But then he breaks it down and says, well, let's look at this. Let's look at it in paragraph two. He says, if you made the ego, how can the ego have made you? This is the premise. The premise is God made us. We wanted to separate. The ego came into being. So how could the ego have made us? So how can it have power over us if we made the ego? That's something to think about. The authority problem is still the only source of conflict because the ego is made out of the wish of God's Son to father him. The ego then is nothing more than a delusional system, I think that's important, in which you made your own father. We were really deluded in what we were doing. He says, make no mistake about it. It sounds insane when it's stated with perfect honesty. Right? We can sit here and we can go, yeah, okay, I get that. I really get that. And he says, but the ego's never going to look on anything with honesty. It's going to lie to us. It's going to feed us whatever it is that it can. So we agree with it. So down to three, you make by projection, but God creates by extension. And we've heard this before. This isn't the first time. Remember, the course is circular. So we're going to be coming around on different ideas again and again. Remembering that, you know, that's what we do. We project. We project it outward because we don't want to look at it. God only loves. He extends love. Because we have to remember the ego projects. God creates. Extension. Down to sentence six in that, yet even the little spark in your mind is enough to lighten it. And we've heard that before too. That we all possess that truth, that spark of truth within us. And given the opportunity, it will light our minds. And so he says, open the dark cornerstone of terror on which it rests and bring it out into the light. And he talks about this many times. You know, we'll see this many times throughout the course is that, you know, don't hide those dark thoughts in your mind. Let the light shine on it. Everything that we have believed has rested on meaninglessness. And everything that we've been afraid of was based on nothing. I mean, think back to anything that maybe you were afraid to embark on, and then you did it. And you're like, oh my gosh, I can't believe I was afraid to do that. Just like when I had to have oral surgery a few weeks ago, I was terrified. I was absolutely terrified in going in there. But the dentist, because I hadn't met her yet because they had switched dentists, they brought in, and the other gal left the practice and she's there. And she just spoke so calmly. It was like Holy Spirit speaking to me. She was so calming, so reassuring, probably the best one I have ever heard out of any dentist. And she just made me feel really at ease. And I really felt that she was a gift to me to help me to relax. Of course, laughing gas helped too, I will tell you. But to be able to be that point to say, yes, I will trust you. Okay, I'm going to be brave. I'm going to do this. And that's kind of what we have to do with this stuff, is say, okay, I know I'm terrified of it. I hear your voice, Holy Spirit, telling me everything's going to be okay. I'm going to take care of you. And then I just kind of have to just trust just a little bit, take that little step outward and see that, yeah, it's going to be okay. And everything is. And everything was for me. I certainly feel a lot better than I did, that's for sure. And then he says at the end of paragraph four there, you will not take this journey alone. I will lead you. So Jesus is leading us to your true Father who hath need of you as I have. Will you answer the call of love with joy? So do we want that love? Do we want that love? Yes, we do. Let's answer that call. So here we are, next section. Number one, the gifts of fatherhood. So we've learned our need of healing. We need to be healed. We got to heal our minds. We're sick, right? That's what he's told us. We're sick. We need help. I know I need help. That's why I do this course, and I do it all the time because I need help. I want to remember the truth of who I am. So recognizing our need for healing in ourselves, oh, there's the beginning of the return to the thought system that we share with God by recognizing I need help. That starts us on our journey. And we've all come to it, right? Because we're here. We're here together sharing in this. And you may think, oh, but maybe I haven't been studying as strongly as I should have, and all this. It's like, but something started you, that you wanted that. You wanted something to change. So we're there in the mind of God. And we're not alone. That's what he says. We're not separated from infinity. No one can be beyond the limitless, because what has no limits must be everywhere. So we're still with God. No beginnings, no endings in God. And then he's just kind of reassuring us, kind of talking us through this idea. Well, you know, you think you're not a part of God, but you are a part of God. And he just kind of keeps going over and over that fact. He says, well, if you're not a part of God, his will then would not be unified. If you really, and he's kind of talking to our intellect here, you know, what's like, well, is this really conceivable? Now, think about this. If this is what I'm telling you, is it really conceivable? Can a part of his mind contain nothing? Can it be outside of it? Can it be separate? So he's appealing to our intelligence. It's like, I know you can understand this, what I'm saying. And so here it seems in time, over to four, waiting is only possible only in time. So it seems like we're waiting to have this great awakening. It seems like it's taking so long. I just want to wake up now. But he says, you know, don't worry, time has no meaning. You who made delay can leave time behind simply by recognizing that neither beginnings nor endings were created by the eternal. It's like, okay, this is just a little classroom I'm in for a while. There's no limits on it. It's okay if it takes me a little longer than someone else. It just seems that way because, in truth, it's all done deal. And that's what we have to remember. Five, if you believe you are, this is 5:3, if you believe you are absent from God, you will believe that He is absent from you. Now we've heard that kind of statement before. See, we think it's the other way around. Oh, God is absent from me. He left me here. He did this to me. All these situations and these people that I had in my life, he did this to me. Somehow I needed punishment. And the thing is, there is no punishment. He didn't do any of this. We have believed that we're isolated from God. And so that's where we need to change our mind, is remember, no, I am with God. He is not incomplete without us. And then certainly this goes on. God has given you a place in his mind that is ours forever. We have to give it. We have to see it in others. His mind cannot be lessened. Love doesn't limit. Joy doesn't limit in any way. And then once again, appealing to our intellect in 7, could any part of God be without his love, and could any part of his love be contained? It's like, now I keep laying it out for you. There's no limits. Everyone is in God's mind. Okay, so think about this again. Can you be without his love? No. So that's what he's kind of going over here in this section. So that, you know, certainly you can take more time with it and journal with it, you know, whatever, and what you're getting on this. But he just kind of keeps saying the same thing over and over in this particular section. Very repetitive he is in this section. Your fatherhood and your father are one. And, you know, he's still reemphasizing that. So turning the page, 196, top of the page, paragraph 8. So yet what you will, you do not know. That denying is to not know. We don't, you know, here's that again. We're denying who we truly are. We don't want to really know who we are. You know, we take less than. We choose to be a victim of God, really, ultimately. But he's saying we must ask what God's will is in everything, because it is ours. It's our will as well. And this isn't like, oh, well, Johnny died and it was God's will. No, that's not what he's talking about here. We hear people say that, usually Christians say that. No, God's will is for perfect happiness, is to see things differently, to recognize my true self, recognize my true self, and other people recognize their true self, that we're all one. That's our will. 9, the projection of the ego makes it appear as if God's will is outside of us. So it's not ours. And that's where the conflict comes in our mind. Remember, everything the ego does wants to push it out into the world. If we want peace, it's out there in the world. God's will, it's out there in the world. It's very simple. It's a very internal, eternal thing. 10, you cannot be happy unless you do what you will truly. And you cannot change this because it is immutable. It is immutable by God's will and yours, for otherwise his will would not be extended. We're afraid to know God's will because we believe it's not ours. This belief is our whole sickness and our whole fear. We don't think we're worthy of God, that we could think with God, that we can be with God, that we can extend love as God has to us. So we hide. 11, we are asked to trust the Holy Spirit only because he speaks for us. He's the voice for God, but never forget that God did not will to be alone. So he's there. He's that bridge. He's there to remind us of who we really are. Sharing the will with us. He doesn't thrust it upon us. Once again, we're not forced to do anything. We have to accept it for ourselves. Always remember that what he gives, he keeps, so that nothing he gives can contradict him. You who share his life must share it to know it, for sharing is knowing. So we have to share the truth. Blessed are you who learn that to hear the will of your Father is to know your own, for it is to your will to be like him, whose will is it is that it be so. And here we go at the last sentence there. That is why healing is the beginning of the recognition that your will is his. Waking up to that, yes, I want to accept God, the truth, love, all of that. I don't like what I've had before. I want something different. I want to know this. That's when my healing begins. So we're going to talk a little bit more about more healing in our next section, section 2, the invitation to healing, page 197. So if sickness is separation, the decision to heal and to be healed is the first step toward recognizing what you truly want. Yay, we just said that, right? Every attack is stepping away from it, right? And every healing thought brings us closer. So we're constantly doing this, back and forth and back and forth. That's okay. You know, it's no big deal. The ego wants to make it a big deal and will talk to us and tell us it's a big deal. As long as we recognize that the ego is talking with us, is going to say these crazy things. It's like, no, I want understanding, and healing is a lesson in understanding. And the more we practice, it says, the better teacher and learner we become. Paragraph two there. If you have denied truth, what better witnesses to its reality could you have than those who have been healed by it? And count yourself among those who have been healed. Oh, but it doesn't seem like I've been healed because I'm so miserable. But it's a sure thing. It's just there. Just like a seed, you know, a seed doesn't grow into anything until it's planted. You gotta water it, you gotta nurture it. Right? And so that's what we're doing with our spiritual, you know, study and our path, is we're watering the seed so it can grow. And so every miracle that we accomplish, every time we shift our perception from fear to love, speaks to us of the fatherhood of God. Every healing thought that we accept from a brother or in our own mind teaches us that we are God's son. So that's what we want to keep reinforcing. That's why it's important to practice. And every hurtful thought you hold, whenever you perceive it, lies the denial of God's fatherhood and your sonship. So it's knowing each thought that I have, which way am I going? Am I going toward recognizing the truth that I'm God's son, or is it taking me away? Denial is as total as love. You cannot deny part of yourself because the rest will seem to be separate and therefore without meaning. To deny meaning is to fail to understand. You can only heal yourself, for only God's son needs healing. Of course, we're working with the Holy Spirit with this. Four, healing is a sign, paragraph four, healing is a sign that you want to make whole. I want to make whole. I don't like the separated self that I am. I don't like being in isolation. I want to make whole. The willingness opens our ears to the voice of the Holy Spirit, because now his message is wholeness. He's going to enable us to go far beyond the healing that we think we could do ourselves. And just our little bit of willingness is what helps to propel us forward. But we have to give him the invitation. Got to send out that invitation to the Holy Spirit. Remember, he's not going to come in and take over. We have to ask him to help us. Paragraph five, then at the bottom of the page, the Holy Spirit cannot speak to an unwelcoming host because he will not be heard. The eternal guest remains, but his voice grows faint in alien company. He needs our protection. Only because your care is a sign that you want him. I want to hear your voice, him, Holy Spirit. And then he says, all you have to do is think like him ever so slightly. Just a little tiny bit. And the little spark becomes a blazing light that fills your mind so that it becomes your only guest. And then whenever we ask the ego to enter, we lessen his welcome. Not that Holy Spirit disappears, but we're allowing the ego to kind of barge in there and take over. Whatever journey we take, he's going with us. It doesn't matter. He's going to wait until we invite him again. Paragraph six, you will never rest until you know your function and fulfill it, for only in this can your will and your Father's be wholly joined. To have him is to be like him. Just keep inviting that knowledge back into our minds. We're never going to feel at peace until we do that. And the Holy Spirit's going to show us how to do this. We just have to recognize that He's there. He's there within us. And then I like this line, 6:6. Your willingness need not be perfect, because His is. We don't have to do anything but just have, oh, just a little tiny bit of willingness. That's the invitation. If we just offer Him that much, He will lighten it so much that it will be increased. And by that increase, we'll recognize and remember creation, who we really are. And then he basically says, would you be hostage to the ego or host to God? And whoever it is that we invite into our minds, just like a house guest, you know, who it is we invite, that's who's going to be there. So think of your mind as your house. And who are you going to invite? Do you want the ego taking you hostage in your own house? Or do you want God there? Do you want the peace of God there? Just have to walk him in there. Okay, so we have one more section. And this one is 3, from darkness to light. Okay, here we are again about that weariness. Starting off about that weariness again. When you are weary, you've done it. You're not bad or anything. It's just you've hurt yourself. And he says your comforter will rest you. So the Holy Spirit is there as our comforter to help us. We can't do it ourselves. We don't know how. For if you did, you could never have grown weary. Unless you hurt yourself, you could never suffer in any way. See, it's our choice that brings us there. Peace surrounds us. We allow it. God is very quiet. There's no conflict. He's not going to rush in, scare us to death. We just have to open up. Remember what we just heard about the willingness, just that little bit of willingness. Conflict is the root of all evil, not money, as we have grown to know. Conflict. Conflict is blind and does not see whom it attacks. The ego is always going to attack us. And so we do need that comfort. We don't know what we're doing. So he says, he knows not what he does. We don't know what we're doing. Believing his will is not his own. Kingdom is ours. It's right there. Kingdom is right there, but we just keep wandering around. We're homeless. We, you know, like the prodigal son, walking around barefoot in the dirt. When we could have something else instead. Oh, my child, paragraph 3, if you knew what God wills for you, your joy would be complete. When the light comes and you have said God's will is mine, you will see such beauty that you will know it is not of you. So all we have to do is accept that. Sometimes we may have to accept it several times during the day, and that's okay. 4, the way is not hard, but it is very different. The way we've been going is the way of pain. God doesn't know that. That way is hard indeed and very lonely. We've known that path. We've been walking that path. Fear and grief are your guests. And they go with us and abide with us. But the dark journey is not our way. Not fitting for a son of God. Walk in light and do not see the dark companions, for they are not fit companions for the Son of God, who was created of light and in light. The great light always surrounds us and shines out from us. How can then we see the darkness when we're focused on the light? So paragraph 5, God hides nothing from us, but we hide ourselves. We can't hide our glory. We try to, but we can't hide it. We will never lose our way. We may wander back and forth, get off the path, but we take a journey that's not real. The dark companions, the dark way, are the illusions. And he says, turn toward the light, for the little spark in you is part of a light so great that it can sweep you out of all darkness forever. For your Father is your creator, and you are like him. We are light. Children of light cannot abide in darkness, for darkness is not in them. So don't listen to those dark thoughts, the fearful, the judgment, the angry, the sad, the depressing, all those thoughts that the ego brings up. Oh, if you do this, you will be happy. If you do that, you will be happy. Don't listen to those dark comforters, he calls them. It seems like it will bring us comfort, right? Well, if I just go on Facebook for a while, it's just a distraction from what the real issue is. We need to remember we can be comforted instead. And he says only, paragraph 7, only God's comforter can comfort you. That's the only one that's going to do it. When you come into the quiet of his temple, he waits for you and then offers you that peace. And you give it as well. Being in the presence of God is what's going to help us. So our mind can be as pure as his, if you would not know what belongs to you. Guard carefully his temple, for he himself dwells there and abides in peace. We can't go to God's presence when we have the dark companions beside us. We can't enter alone. We need our brothers. So when you're upset with somebody, take that brother with you into the temple. Say, Holy Spirit, this brother, I'm feeling conflicted about. I want to see the truth in both of us. I want to experience the peace of God. Let me see this person differently. Let me see the light in them. Paragraph 8. In your mind, you can accept the whole sonship and bless it with the light your Father gave it. Then you will be worthy to dwell in the temple with him, because it is your will not to be alone. Don't let the ego talk to you about that word worthy. It's real easy for the ego to say, oh, but you are not worthy. There's something wrong with you. You're not doing this perfectly. You're not accepting the whole sonship. The ego does that. See how you can take these words in the course and work against us. Because then we'll say, oh, I can't do this course. Can't do it. But you can. God blessed his son forever. If you will bless him in time, you will be in eternity. Time cannot separate you from God if you use it on behalf of the eternal. So everything we do here, we can use it on God's behalf. So that ends today. Looking at next time, session 19, still in chapter 11, we'll be doing 4 through 8, the inheritance of God's son, the dynamics of the ego, waking to redemption, the condition of reality, the problem, and the answer. So that's what we'll be doing next time. So thanks so much for joining us today. Namaste.